Okay, so welcome to this session. And the first speaker is Franco Barbanera, who is going to talk about multi-compatibility for multi-party session composition. So please.
Good morning, everyone. Thank you for being here. I'll be talking about multi-compatibility for multi-party session composition, which is a joint work with Dezzani, Gary, and Nobuko Yoshida. Now, after a short introduction, I will talk a bit about this participants as interfaces approach for system composition, and then I'll go to the core of the talk, which is the results for PPDP 23, which is the extension of this approach for composition of several systems. Well, all we know that concurrent and distributed systems are not standalone entities, and especially nowadays, they are part of a never-terminated jigsaw. There is no universal law, but I guess we all could agree that a good composition method to compose together two or more systems to get a new one with maybe different capabilities, well, a good composition method should be conservative. It should alter as less as possible the single systems we want to compose to connect together. It should be flexible, that is, system independent. The composition mechanisms should be not part of the system and should allow to compose also systems that are not developed to be composed but are actually closed ones, and should be safe. Of course, a good composition method should guarantee not to break relevant properties of the systems that we compose. In a nutshell, a good composition method is safe when, if one starts from a system, from systems that look like that, one shouldn't end up with something like this. And so, now, a brief introduction to the approach of system composition that it's called participants as interfaces. It's a very simple idea, and that's nice because at least simple ideas shouldn't be wrong. It was introduced, as far as we know, in this paper in 2018. Now I present it in a very abstract and general way. Let us assume we have a system S1 which is composed by several components, several participants, and just we decide to pick one of them, CH, which does something, is supposed to do something, and its behavior is something like that. You see that in this discussion, I abstract from the way communications are performed and from the logical order of the exchange messages. It does something, gets some message M, and is able to send messages M prime and prime and then so on. Now, we can look at this behavior not as the behavior of that particular component, but it can be looked at as the behavior of another system that offer and accept from us some messages. And so, if in case we wish to compose S1 with another system, S2, maybe it's the case that we find another participant in S2, which has a behavior somewhat compatible with the behavior of our component H. So we decided to compose the system using this behaviors that we look at as interfaces, sort of interfaces. And we do that because they are compatible. An input of H is can be provided by an output of K and vice versa. So we can connect the two systems in a very, very, very simple way by replacing the two participants with the gateways, with the simple forwarders. The message M that H received now is forwarded to the other component and is used as message that the component K could send to the rest of its partners. So the composition is simply obtained in this way. This description is very, very abstract. So from that we can find out that this method is definitely conservative because we do not change the system, but just the two interfaces that are interfaces, the two components that we looked at as interfaces, and we replace that by forwarders. It's definitely flexible because it does not depend on the particular implementations of the systems, and you see the two systems could have been closed once, so it managed to compose closed systems, not developed from scratch for composition. And well, we have to check if it is safe. Well, to check if it is safe, we have to check this property on a particular formalism, a particular way we implement systems. And it's rather safe, fairly safe, because we have plenty of evidence of this fact, because there are a number of results of the safeness of this method composition, for instance, in the multiparty session type formalism, and in the formalism of communicating finite-state machines. For multiparty session types, there are results for systems that communicates in a synchronous way. There are more results for communicating finite-state machines because we checked for synchronous and asynchronous communication. Of course, for both synchronous and asynchronous communication, some condition have to be put on the component that we use as interfaces. For instance, in the communicating finite-state machine, we cannot have a mixed choice and something like that. And for the synchronous case, the condition should be more stricter. In any case, we saw safeness is guaranteed by the compatibility of interfaces. In all the results I mentioned before, the compatibility is roughly, in some cases exactly, by simulation, as one could guess. But now there is a missing further step to do, because it has been investigated up to now only the connection of two systems via single interfaces. And this has a drawback, because by connecting systems 2x2, we get at the end a whole system which is sort of a tree topology. So we're missing the investigation of simultaneous multiple connections. As you can guess, this very simple idea is very simply, fortunately, extendable to simultaneous multiple system composition. For instance, if you have four systems and you choose four different participants acting as possible interfaces, you can connect the four system by replacing these components by forwarders. Of course, now it's you see, you can compose that in several different ways, not in a single one like the binary case. Here, you replace H with a forwarder that once A is accepted as a message received, is forwarded to the component W, which then sends it to the rest of its system. But you can see that we can have another situation when H receives A and forwards A to K, while the A that is received by V is forwarded to W. So we are in the case that we have many possible different connection policy. All safe, in general, they cannot be all safe, but we have to check which connection policies are safe, and we have to generalize the compatibility relation in order to get safe composition. For this paper, we choose a formal setting for investigation, which is the setting of multiparty session types that I briefly recall here. Multiparty session types are a body of cryptographic formalisms where two distinct but related views of a concurrent system do coexist, which is the global view. The overall behavior, the global view is the description, the overall behavior of a system, and usually formalized with what is called global type, and there are local views. And local views describe behavior of the single components, usually in a suitable process algebra.
We lost the signal. I'm sorry about that. Should be fixed.
Yeah. Okay, thank you so much. So, these formalisms are characterized by this distinct view of the systems, and there are many formalisms. Two classes are the one I discussed, but there are many other way of approaching multiparty session types. But a set of formalisms can be called, for instance, top-down MPST, where communication protocols are explicitly described as global types and subsequently by projecting them by using a projection function, local types are obtained for implementation. And in general, systems obtained by projecting well-formed global types enjoy good communication properties. Of course, we have no global type can be used for this purpose. Then, bottom-up multiparty session types are other formalisms where no projection is used at all and the local behaviors are checked against global types by means of type assignment systems. Even here, system typeable with well-formed global types enjoy good communication properties. A particular bottom-up multiparty session type formalism is the one developed by Design and others, which is called calculus of session, where we have processes, very simple ones, that are simple, are conductively defined, possibly infinite terms, and the processes can just receive or send a number of messages. You know, these processes in this formalism plays both the roles of process and local types, because the processes are so simple that local types usually used in multiparty session types are fused together with processes. A multiparty session is a set of parallel named processes, and session multiparty sessions are equipped with asynchronous operational semantics. It's the one can expect, since if P and Q are willing to send and receive some messages respectively from the other element of the pair, a communication can be fired. For this calculus, there are global types which describe the possible overall behavior of a system. These global types are the form P send a message, one of the message lambda I to Q, and then proceeds as GI. Everything looks sequential, but if in GI there is another communication from R to R to S, the communication P to Q and R to S are to be considered as independent and can work in parallel. Then we have a coinductive type system, which enables to derive judgment of this sort, which says that the session M, the system M, can be typed with G. The system is the double bar stands for coinduction definition, and so this is the type system, which is extremely simple, just saying that the empty session is described by the global type and the other rule enables to say that if P and Q can exchange message lambda I, then the global type which describes the possible behavior or the whole system is of the form described in the conclusion. The main result for this formalism is that if the global type we assign to M, if G is well formed, then M is lock free, that is, any participants can actually progress. Our contribution to the PPDP is that we exploit the participant at interfaces approach for in this particular calculus, so for multiparty session types, for the connection of several systems simultaneously. Of course, in this case, if we have several systems we wish to connect, of course we represent them as sessions, and the participants are described in the formalism. For instance, now H can receive A, and if H can receive A and then send C, this is the description of the behavior of H in this way. He can receive from Q an A and then send to P a C, where P is some other component of the system M1. Now, for this formalism, we have to formalize our connection policies in some way, and we can formalize particular connection policies as sessions, as different sessions. For instance, this is the representation, abstract representation we saw before, and we are using in the present example. And if we wish to describe this particular connection policies, where the message received A, the message A received from by H is sent to K, well, we can do that using some fictitious participant K1, K2, K3, and K4, and describing in the process of these participants the way they can forward each other the message they are able to send or to receive. Now, in the example, the connection policy can be described in via a multi-party session. In this way, there are with a session with four participants because we have four systems, and for each of these systems, we choose a particular component to act as an interface. For this specific session, we can prove that the session is typeable. That is, in the type system, we can derive that the connection policy K can be typed by the system you see here, by the G, H send to KA, W send to VB, and so on. Well, the main result is that we can get a safe composition via gateways out of a typeable connection policy. That this is our notion of multi-compatibility. So, if you take a set of systems, and for each of them, you manage to pick up, you decide to pick up some participant to act as possible interfaces, and then use them replaced by forwarders. If you have a set of systems like that, and you manage to find a connection policy between these the interfaces, and this policy can be typed, well, out of that you can get a safe composition. That is, you can define the composition of the four systems, and you simply, out of the behavior of the components you choose as interface, and out of the behavior of the of the participants describing the connection policy, well, out of them, fusing them together, you obtain the forwarders you need. So, typeability for some connection policy is now the extension of the notion of compatibility in a setting where you wish to compose several systems simultaneously. The main result is this theorem, saying that if M1 and MN are session systems formalized in the session calculus, which are typeable and then lock-free, and if K is a session that describes a communication policy and this communication policy is typeable, then the composition you get is typeable as well, and hence lock-free. So the property of lock freedom is not lost by gateway connection. I have good news because there are also new results, not only in the setting of bottom-up multi-party session types, but also for top-down multi-party session types, because Gary and Yoshida produced this paper, which will be presented on Friday at 4 p.m. at Room 1. And they exploited this sort of approach to system connection in the setting of top-down multi-party session types with which their approach has some advantages and also some disadvantages that you can check. For the future, of course, one should plan to extend the approach for asynchronous communications. And we would like to extend this approach in the context of communicating finite state machines. And to extend this single interface, multiple system with single interface in a setting where the interfaces are many for each system. And exactly this is the Gary and Yoshida paper as a result for many interfaces, many systems and several interfaces. And so it's likely in future we will manage to merge the two different approaches in order to get something more powerful. And it's 25 minutes, okay. Thank you very much for your attention.
Ivanko, there was something that confused me. The diagrams that you gave and the explanation that you gave to the diagram seems to contradict. So could you go back to slide, I think, slide 10, I think, 10 or 11? Yeah, this one. So yeah, so go to the previous one, sorry. So go to 8? So. No, that's forward. Yeah, this one. So you talked about connecting these two components, and you looked at the inputs and the outputs. Now, I'm not familiar with your area enough to be able to judge, but I would say, well, if I have something that outputs on M and then something that inputs on M, outputs M and inputs M, then I connect that. I make the output become the input of the other one.
Yeah.
But if you go to the next diagram, that's not what you do. Because now what goes into M gets sent to the other one, and that gets output again.
The one on the left gets M as input.
Yeah.
And then forwards it to the right-hand component, which uses what it gets as the output M.
So I was expecting that you would draw an arrow from the right-hand side to the left-hand side, so it goes out and goes in. So you... No. So put your hand on the right-hand side. Sorry. So the right-hand side outputs M.
Outputs M, yes.
And the left-hand side inputs M.
M, yes.
So I would connect the output to the input.
No, because, you see, the M received by H, this M received by H, is a message from other components of the system, because H, up to now, until we connected the system, H is a component, normal component, which does its job. For instance, it received M from Ciccio, which is in its own system. In the other system, K makes his fairly good job, and one of its duty is to send M to Pippo in the other system. Now, we decide to look at the behavior of the components as an interface, in the sense they wish to see. We look at them as describing the behavior of another system. So it's like saying H receive M, but I can see H as an interface in the sense I can be connected with a system which is able to receive the M I'm receiving from Ciccio. The M I received from Ciccio is now something that another system, an outer system, is expecting from me.
Sorry to interrupt. So, but at the moment, K is capable of sending out M by itself. So why does it need supply from H to send out M? M is generated inside K at the moment. It can output M.
M can output, of course, but you see, maybe M does, the K does his job, but you find out that this job can be made in a finer way and in a more powerful way, in a faster way, by another system. So instead of using K, you decide to use another system that can provide the same things that K does, but in a different way. Of course, the behavior, communication behavior, is the same, but maybe the system can provide you with more features of what you get.
Okay. Second question. Yeah. Your diagram suggests that you have to connect all the inputs and outputs.
Yes.
Is that necessary? I mean, is it just connect one?
It's not strictly necessary. Okay. For simplifying proof, you just take a component and substitute it with forwarders that forwards all the message. But you can decide to forward only partial, a subset of the messages. So you can decide, for instance, that the M sent by K, it's enough for your system. So you decided just to forward part of the message. It's a fairly simple extension of the approach.
Thank you. I think there is one more time. So I wish to thank the speaker again.